Hello and welcome to another Overlord Lore video, and thanks to my Patreons for supporting this channel. Today's topic will be about Overlord's equivalent to male K-pop groups, the Pleiades Battlemaids. These Baltales Battle Sisters are one of the most unique and interesting attempts at creating kick-ass servants. They all have character, a distinct personality, and a very unique and memorable design. And in this introduction, something that I should have made far, far earlier, we will go over the general idea behind them, how they fight, followed by a brief afterthought. And with that said, let's get started. The six not-blood-related sisters, together with the homunculi mates, Sebastian, aka Tachmi's personal butler, possibly Orioli Omigar, and Pistonia, were all created as servants. Back in Yggdrasil, their existence was in part based on a roleplay purpose. At some point, the supreme beings in their supreme chambers on their supreme floors thought it would be beneath their avatars to clean after themselves. So they came up with the idea of mates. So while the 41 supreme beings were plotting evil schemes, the mates would take care of the tomb and made sure that it always looked presentable. But the player, these battle mates, serve an additional purpose. They are the last NPC defense of the Great Tomb of Nazarick. Their entire purpose is to be nice, shiny, beautiful, distracting, and deadly enough to buy the much needed time for all of the supreme beings to assemble in a last ditch effort to throw back the tide of invaders together with any remaining NPCs and weapons available to them. So after having lost basically the entire tomb, the 41 members of Iron Soulgown planned this last showdown to be a boss fight against themselves. This was, by the way, Ulbert's idea, since he figured that everybody calling them monsters for playing heteromorphs anyway, so it would be great to take on the role in general and present themselves as the evil adversaries they pretended to be. So a boss fight against the evil masters of the Great Tomb of Nazarick would be more than fitting. But even with their powers combined, once somebody somehow managed to break through the 8th floor, where the overwhelming, irresistible might of Nazarick is located, it was assumed that they would have such strength, or such numbers, that they would also be able to defeat the 41 supreme beings fairly easily. So victory for the Great Tomb of Nazarick was unlikely, but not impossible. So under this plan, all the Pleiades were expected to do was to delay invaders, not to outright defeat them. And since this was one of those scenarios that were extremely unlikely to happen, they also weren't given access to the full level count of 100, which would be much better spent in the 8th floor anyway, where every bit of strength matters the most. Therefore, with the exception of Orioli Omigar and Sebastian, their level count are between 63 and 46. And therefore, their creators had to make the best out of the limited resources at their disposal. And boy oh boy, they precisely did that. The sisters are a fine-tuned fighting unit, able to support, augment, and defend one another excellently, which becomes quite apparent once we take a look at their two deployment options. The Pleiades as a battle group can be organized and structured into two surprisingly distinct standard formations, with two vastly different battle tactics, the Six Star and the Seven Sister Formation. And the Seven Star Formation derives its name from the Seven Daughters of Atlas, the titan that bears the world on his shoulders. Also, I bet Archimedes always wanted to know this titan's precise location, for a scientific experiment, of course. Jokes aside, I also found it quite interesting that Atlas is not only the name of a world item, but one that was already in Iron Soulgown's possession, but it was stolen by an unknown enemy. So maybe there exists a link between the Pleiades and Atlas. Especially Oriole, the youngest sister, is a candidate for any possible connections, since thus far she remained an unknown quantity and is stationed at the 8th floor, together with the main force of Nazarick's legions. But regardless if this theory is true or not, the Seven Sister Formation consists of Yuri Alpha, Lupus Regina Beta, Naberal Gamma, Shizu Delta, Solution Epsilon, Entoma Vasilisa Zeta, and is either led or accompanied by Oriole Omega, the seventh and the youngest sister. But despite being regarded as the youngest, she is level 100, making her much stronger level-wise than any other Pleiades, and she is normally stationed at the Cherry Blossom Sanctuary somewhere in the 8th and the strongest floor, where she supervises and reroutes the teleportation network. Therefore, I assume that should the 8th floor be somehow overwhelmed, something that has never happened thus far, she would use her mastery over teleportation to link up with the rest of the sisters and buff them, since she is a commander class build. We also don't know if she leads the Pleiades head on first, or focuses on her role as a support unit, on buffing, augmenting and setting goals, and delegates the direct leadership role to Yuri Alpha, who is the deputy leader of the Pleiades and referred by all the Pleiades, and even the normal mates as Big Sis. And while we didn't have seen Oriole fight, in fact we have seen nothing so far of her, it is at this point quite obvious that her buffs are incredibly powerful. I say this because while being buffed by Oriole in the 13th light novel, the doppelganger Shizu Delta, a mere level 46 soldier build, was able to interrupt Einzelgaon's spellcasting not once but twice, and still managed to remain hidden from him. And this is extremely remarkable, because not only is a greater doppelganger not as effective as the original in terms of stats, Shizu Delta should never be able to hurt Ainz, much less interrupt his spellcasting, since Shizu's attacks would normally be negated by one of Ainz's skills, high-tier physical nullification, which nullifies all damage from any attack from a being below the level of 60. And the fact that Doppel Shizu was able to do so speaks volumes about how powerful the buffs of Oriole are, granting Shizu more or less a power boost of 25% in total, though interrupting a spell might also be related to attack damage in and of itself, which in case of Shizu Delta is immense, considering her relative low level. So maybe all Oriole did was disabling the damage immunity of Ainz via buffing Doppelganger Shizu, but even then, it would still be remarkable. And if Oriole was around at this time, she could not only recast her buffs, but also bestow additional ones. Not to mention that she would still be a level 100 being, and therefore incredibly overpowered in relationship to anything but other players, NPCs, and the Dragon Lords. This also implies that if all of the Pleiades are buffed by Oriole, and she is among them, the other sisters should be able to fight akin to a level 60 or even to a level 80 being. On the flip side, I would assume that the biggest weakness of this formation would be an exceptionally strong level 100 foe, someone along the line of Shaltir or Touch Me, who would be able to handle all of the buffed Pleiades for a brief period of time, and who's also significantly stronger than the supporter Oriole Omega. And once she was eliminated, the rest of the formation would fight much less effective and would soon struggle again with high-tier nullification abilities. And this is the 7th Sister Formation. The other, the 6th Star Formation, derives its name not from Atlas and his daughters, but from the similar named Star Constellation. The 6th brightest of them, to be more precise. And this unit features all of the previous mentioned Pleiades, except Oriole, who is replaced by Sebastian, the Butler of Steel. So even if she couldn't make it out in time before the 8th floor was overrun, Touch Me's creation could fill the gap, and would grant the group access to a dedicated level 100 Monk melee build. This deployment option is also far more viable in any outside deployment, since potentially all of the Pleiades and Sebas can be assembled with relative ease, while Oriole Omega is in charge of the internal teleportation network of Nazarick, and therefore basically irreplaceable unless under attack. Without the significant buffs Oriole can employ, the group suffers a fair bit of overall battle efficiency, but in turn, gains a frontline fighter. And therefore, rather than acting like a broad battle formation, it stands to reason that the by comparison weaker Pleiades will focus on supporting Sebastian via healing spells, cover fire, and generally distracting enemy formations and keeping them occupied, while Sebas devastates the bulk of the enemy forces. The main weakness would presumably be two or more high-level beings, since Sebas would be busy at least for a time fighting one of them, and the nullification ability of the other enemy might render most attacks of the other Pleiades useless against it. And after this enemy defeated the Six Sisters, both of them could team up against Sebas. Besides these normal formations, if the situation demands it, each member can be deployed separately or combined with other forces. For example, Sebas and Solution formed an intelligence gathering unit. Nabral accompanied Ainz, while Lupus Regina indirectly helped Inferia create a hybrid health and stamina replenishing potion. And Shizu thus far was the only Pleiades who was paired with Nea, who at this point was still an outsider for an extended period of time. And while Shizu is currently traveling with Ainz, she may return to Nea in order to provide her with support, friendship, and a lot of head pads. And I also want to mention that the sisters were created separately from another and with different karma values, which could lead to problems further down the line. For example, Nabral Gamma, who thinks less than kind about humans, was, while traveling with Momon, permanently on the brink of killing these annoying insects. While on the other hand, Yuri Alpha and Shizu Delta, the two safe Pleiades, had such self-control that they managed to keep themselves from fighting Evil Eye, the girl that almost killed one of their sisters, without a serious killing intent. But this in turn also means that they would be hesitant to massacre a bunch of civilians, if the situation demands it. And their different karma values also leads to differences in their formation. Since, for example, Yuri Alpha was shocked how sadistic Lupus Regina was, especially in regards to the villagers she is supposed to protect. Something that Yuri also doesn't like about Solution Epsilon, who takes great pleasure in devouring humans alive, preferably the unspoiled ones. And last but not least, it should be noted that the Pleiades themselves are seen as stars, pun intended, and idols in the eyes of the regular Humunculi mates. To them it was an extremely traumatizing experience to be just one level under the 8th floor as the Great Raid took place. Now I know this seems odd at first, considering that the mates back when they were just data in a video game rather than actual living beings should not be able to perceive their environments. But whatever was the cause for the Great Tomb's transportation to the new world, it apparently affected time in rather curious ways. Not only is the transportation of players apparently delayed and only happens every 100 years, the NPCs also remembered part of their old existence. Hence why Shaldi was able to share the profession of Buku Buku Shagamasa. And this is also the reason the mates remembered the battle on the 8th floor, where all hell and Rubedo had broken loose. And this battle was probably akin to nothing the new world has ever seen. Only the War of the Eight Greed Kings might have gotten somewhat close to this extreme catastrophe. And therefore the level 1 mates, who are scared of the outside world anyway, were all the more thankful that the Pleiades were there to protect them. They are seen as symbols of luck, but also as an assurance that some of their own can fight back and protect the rest. And I really like this particular piece of world building. It provides us with a different perspective. While we naturally are focused on Ainz, the Floor Guardians and the Dragon Lords, to which by comparison the Pleiades are weak and insignificant, the Humunculi mates are focused on them, which makes them by comparison strong and admirable. And with that said, thank you for watching and special thanks to Al Capone, Angel of Death, Bad Guy E, Hector Moreno, Hoss, Jason, Chromius, Lord Gastar, Lord Touch Me, Matthew Rod, Minnow 13, Mirtis, Serge, and Vash Hawkeye for supporting this channel. Thanks, guys. Anyway, have a nice day. Over and out.